This episode of Talking Simpsons is brought to you by Audible, and you listeners can go to audibletrial.com/lasertime and get started with a free 30-day trial and get a free audiobook.
What the hell are you staring at?
What the hell are you staring at, everyone? And welcome to Talking Duckman. This is the Lasertime Podcast Network's one-off episode about the animated sitcom Duckman. I'm your host, Bob Mackey, and I'm anything but ugly. And who else is here today?
It's Henry Gilbert. Hi.
And who else is here?
It's Chrissy, comfortable at laughing at old stereotypes, Antista.
And today's episode is about Face, which aired on June 4th, 1994. And Chris will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real life history.
You let you down, down! It thrust your pelvis, huh! 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 It thrust your pelvis.
That was the Funky Duckman, everyone.
Oh, man, Bobby! You wouldn't believe what happened today. President Bill Clinton celebrates the 50th anniversary of D-Day. The last episode of Duckman, Nicole Brown Simpson, could have watched first run. It's going to air next week. And for you animation fans out there, Steven Spielrock's The Flintstones debuts in theaters.
Oh, awesome. Wow. Well, what a collection of bad events that happened
you
in this day.
You told me to make the news bad for
yeah,
the Duckman.
So, yeah, for Duckman, it's all bad news that happened on this day. So I want to say this is all my fault. Bob Mackey, me. Please level your insults at me if you don't like this. But I wanted to do one episode about Duckman.
Yeah.
Because it is a very, very 90s show. And I personally love it. I think it's aged incredibly well, even though it is sort of a time capsule for the 90s. Mm.
Like we did with The Critic, it is a Simpsons adjacent show.
Yeah.
Yes.
That premiered at this time in the chronology of The Simpsons. Though we're not doing the first episode of Duckman.
Exactly.
It also is done by Klasky Csupo. And you have to imagine that by the time they're kicked off The Simpsons, they align themselves with USA Network and Duckman.
This is very much them trying to do their own Simpsons.
Yeah.
To get something out of the way first, we're doing the episode about Face. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't seen it recently, and I bet you haven't, all of these episodes are on YouTube in their full and complete form. Mm-hmm. Go off, watch this episode 20 minutes, back and listen to it. It's about Face.
I love Duckman. I know a lot of Talking Simpsons fans don't listen to Laser Time, but I bring it up a lot because it is a very special cartoon for me.
Yeah.
It's in the era of it's one of the only Simpsons rip-offs, Me Too's that I think, wow, this is different and great.
It really has its own voice and its own attitude.
And
I feel like you said, Chris, this is very much Klasky Csupo.
Mm-hmm.
So to give you more information on them, in case you weren't aware, they were the folks who animated the seasons 1 through 3 mm-hmm. of The Simpsons, and they were let go in season 4 for Film Roman, who continues to animate The Simpsons. But I feel like this is very much Klasky Csupo's own Simpsons. That's what they wanted.
It is, and Klasky Csupo is defined by, look-wise, by Rugrats, most famously,
yes,
and Rocket Power,
so.
and Wild Thornberries. That's what their shit looks like. But it works better here because it's intentionally jarring and jagged and
yes.
mean and awful and gross to look at.
Well,
I love it.
Because in the late 80s, there weren't a ton of animation studios you could work out of. And so when they drew The Simpsons, when they were producing it, they did it out of the Klasky Csupo offices.
Mm-hmm.
That's where David Silverman, Wes Archer, all the original Simpsons animators were animating there. And so when they lost the Simpsons deal, then they were already still going strong. They had Rugrats, but they were looking for a new late night show. And
yeah,
I think the prime time show.
A lot of their stuff isn't going to hold up, partially due to the style that they chose, which is a bold choice.
Yeah, I mean, I think it works really well on Duckman and things like Aw Real Monsters, where it's like this is supposed to be ugly.
Yes, and, sorry, I should have said that. That looks great.
I mean, it looks so good.
Visually, that show is amazing.
And I mean, Duckman has a lower budget than The Simpsons, but I feel like Duckman.
I would say some of the Nicktoons.
What's that?
I would say a lower budget than some of the Nicktoons.
A little
shows.
Bit, yeah. But I think this episode looks good. But I want to say Duckman is just a fun character to look at. I like his design. I like how his eyes are independent from his face. They just exist on his glasses.
They
never made a Duckman figure.
Yeah.
Ever.
Yeah.
They never made any Duckman merchandise.
And I like the resting Duckman face is just his teeth are out.
Yeah.
And he just looks like such a dweeb.
Glasses are his eyeballs. And just it's based on a comic created by Everett Peck.
Yes.
As far as how many comics were out before this show debuted? Because I think there's like 12 Duckman comics.
Not a whole lot. So like The Simpsons, I feel like, so a TV critic named Jamie Weinman, he believes that artist-created cartoons do better than ones who aren't created by artists because the characterization is also part of the drawings themselves. So King of the Hill, you know, drawn by Mike Judge. Beavis and Butthead, drawn by Mike Judge. I mean, Simpsons, drawn by Matt Groening.
And someone was, I don't know, just reminded me of that, like, Groening, like, yeah, he chose to make the color yellow, so when you, in a world of channel flipping, like, you'd know exactly what you were seeing that was actually, the second you flew by.
That was actually a woman at Klasky Chupa who made that arbitrary decision. Yeah, so, but and so Groening was on board with it.
And Duckman's the same way. You wouldn't, you wouldn't confuse it for something else.
I mean, that's the similarities to The Simpsons, too, that you have a primetime animated sitcom aimed at adults starring a yellow family.
Yeah. Yes.
Except they're meaner, more 90s, and more set in a specific area and place. And also, like,
they exist in L.A. for the most part. Their version of L.A.
And it's way sexier.
It
or
is.
Sexual, I'd say.
It's so cool.
It's a bit ribald. So,
it,
I mean,
It does, but like, there's so much of this, and I'm sure I'll get into it. Yeah, it's a good sitcom, but more so than any cartoon, primetime cartoon show of the 90s, this reminds me the most of classic Looney Tunes.
Oh, okay,
this is a classic Looney Tunes premise.
There's a lot of Tex Avery gags baked into a lot of what we're going to talk about today, but you mentioned the comics, so Everett Peck, you might have heard his name. I like that his name is Everett Peck, and his show is Duckman, by the way. Peck, Duckman. And he worked in animation a bunch. He actually did character designs on The Real Ghostbusters, so he's used to drawing ugly things. And he was also a character designer on The Critic, and I think Vladimirovich, that character, is a very much an Everett Peck-looking character.
Yes, as you said on the Talking Critic episode we did, And I think that, you know, that's still a thing even now, that a lot of independent artists I know who draw their own comics, their day job is working in animation.
Right, yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
So Everett Peck wasn't that different, and I read in, well, so how did it come to be then?
So Duckman has a very weird origin. So Peck drew him in some surrealist, just strips, not full books, for the comic Dark Horse Presents in 89, 88, and 90. And then he got his own one-shot Dark Horse comic in 1990. So that is sort of the comic book origin of Duckman. I have not read these comics.
They're not a lot. And they're really, I've never, ever in my life seen one in the wild.
I never have either. All I know, the difference is his wife is alive in the comic book, where in the series she's dead, which I think gives the series a more interesting angle than
I
a suffering wife.
It totally does, because it's not just, at the time, sitcoms always had the dumbass dad and the bitch ass wife.
Yeah.
And this at least.
You want to put it in those terms, sure.
It's the 90s. Welcome back.
It is the harpy wife, like the fun ruining wife.
If you've been in the comments lately calling us a bunch of SJWs, then like enjoy some Duckman, because that is like the most anti PC.
You know, by making his wife dead and making the battle axe, he fights with somebody who doesn't even love him and would never sleep with him.
Yeah, that's the premise of the show. He lives with his children and the twin sister of his dead wife who hates him.
Yes.
So their relationship makes much more sense and is funnier, and it benefits from that so well.
And we learn in episode 3 of the series that he accidentally killed his wife through a crazy chain reaction of events. So
it's
Duckman
horrible,
has to live. He has to live with the guilt of killing his wife, and also has to live with his wife's twin sister who hates him, and he's also a total dirtbag. But the fact that he doesn't have a wife means he can date. We can see Duckman. We can see it's not a family sitcom, but an animated sitcom where there could be the talk of relationships and things like that. Things the Simpsons never really get into because they can't. To go over the production history of the Duckman, this could have been a Fox show, which would have been awesome. But Fox was like, "We'll order 2 episodes from you, and we'll see what happens." USA was like, "We'll do a full season." So they went to USA, and that's where it stayed for 4 years.
Well, and Peck said that he was just. It sounded like a real Star Is Born type moment where Gabor Chupo saw his Duckman design. I was like, that should be the next show. That should be it. Like, it was just plucked out of the crowd. Like, I'll make this the show. And so Everett went from being just a designer to an executive producer of the show, as a writer and executive producer who oversaw the show with other writers.
And the show was, according to Peck, treated pretty fairly by the network for the first 2 years. And then after that, it dropped off the map. The series went on for 4 years at like 70 episodes.
70 episodes.
But when I bought the DVDs like 8 years ago, the fourth season was completely new to me. It aired like on Monday at 3 a.m. on USA.
Even spend this money on this?
It didn't have that Weird Science buoy to...
No, those first 2 years were the Weird Science bump. It's just like Weird Science and Duckman together on Saturday nights on USA.
And I should tell you, if you were... It's symbolic... Knowing Duckman as well as I do is symbolic of who I was at the time. A loser who had nothing to do on Friday nights. 10 o'clock was my time to shine. Weird Science and Duckman.
Well, if you're 14, Duckman, how could you be popular?
I'm a little older
things.
Than you, Bob. Okay. I had no excuse.
Well, though, also, you need to also understand in the pre-internet time, mm-hmm. the USA Up All Night block was like, that was your internet porn. Yeah. Like, that was, if you were a young person discovering themselves, you were probably masturbating to that, not to internet
yeah,
porn.
All night.
Like, censored trauma movies all night
yes,
long,
that's
basically.
The
yeah.
best way to put it. Stewardess school on repeat, PG blowjob scenes as far as the eye can see.
So you'd watch Weird Science, which would have a ton of PG-13 sex jokes. Mm-hmm. Then Duckman, which would constantly would have so many jokes of like, well, are we going to show a nipple this time? I don't know. And then they just go into a straight up Cinemax porn movie, except with the sex taken out of it.
Yeah, with the sex replaced with commercials. Yes. I have no idea how many times I sat there, dick in hand. Like, just the idea that, like, well, what's the movie going to be? It's just random.
Yeah,
you don't
yeah,
even
you're
know.
Never going to know.
I
mean,
it'll be terrible.
The rest of these scenes.
Ooh, Firehouse Boys. This is going to be great.
USA was not then what they are now. Mm-hmm. They were barely a network. In fact, they would make fun of USA on Duckman way more than the Simpsons would make fun of Fox. Like, there were jokes like, USA, are they on at night?
Yeah.
And the jokes about how they would just air Wings all day because
it's
they just had a lot of Wings reruns. Yeah.
And I was doing my best to look up what USA's original programming block looked like around this time.
Silk Stockings? I don't know.
It did. Silk Stockings and eventually La Femme Nikita, which for a mild bit of sexiness meeting respectability, but Red Shoe Diaries, a show that was with nudity that was on Showtime, but USA Network made its bones by being basically the first basic cable channel. So if you have cable, you have USA. But they didn't have a lot of original programming. The most notable one that I know of is when Airwolf got canceled by NBC. USA bought it, but decided, you know, we can't afford a lot of helicopter shots.
Yeah, leave the helicopter behind. Bring Asner over.
Thank God we have access to
Ernest Borgnine.
It's all archival footage from the original NBC seasons.
No, they kill off Borgnine in the first USA episode.
Okay.
They can't afford him.
And I just have to plug this. This is an old episode of Cheap Popcast that Dave did once the WWE Network came out. If you don't know what
I've heard this one, too.
And WWE Network basically puts together, warts and all, every single uncut episode of WWF at the time, Raw.
Yes, Monday Night Raw.
Monday Night Raw, which has been on USA forever. So this whole period, Jerry Lawler is wearing Duckman shirts. I'm like, these dudes turning into Duckman!
They're all new, they're SA! Duckman's a new generation of Duckman.
I see.
He's like the new WWF generation, you know?
Well, he advertised everything of like, Tech Wars coming to USA.
But Dave has a whole episode about just Duckman promos on wrestling.
And they talk to Cornfed, who calls in to WWF. I don't know why.
I'm sitting next to a ham, and I believe we have a ham on the line, do we?
Duckman Detective Agency, Duckman 8 here. This is Cornfed speaking. Your dime, your time. Go ahead.
There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Cornfed is going to be with us. We'll be right back with Cornfed and the matchup.
For USA Network, Duckman and Weird Science and Up All Night helped them find an identity, but their first true hit was Monday Night Raw in the late 90s when it was really taking off in 1998. Nothing outdid Raw on USA, and so all their
show they do not own.
All their other shows would have WWE guest stars. Mm-hmm. They're like, oh, on this episode of the bicycle cop show that had a Mario Lopez.
I fucking know what you're talking about. What
Pacific
called?
Blue?
Pacific Blue.
That's right.
What it was.
Good.
On that, they're like, well, in this episode, well, the woman on the team's going undercover into prison, and Sable's there.
Wow.
And
wow.
So, it's all stuff like
I wouldn't know what they're airing on USA Network. I think SNL did a sketch on, like, what is Burn Notice?
Yes.
No idea.
I know their shows have characters, which they mention a lot. Just
well,
like,
now they've moved beyond Burn Notice or the doctor one, Royal Pains? No.
I don't know.
This is also baffling. I don't watch this channel.
All I know is Psych, and that's all I know.
But it was the first cable, obviously through Cartoon Express, and to a much lesser extent, Calliope.
And they were the first network to hire Nickelodeon's Doug to do animated
Doug premiered
promos.
In an animated promo on USA.
Yeah.
I think Klasky Chupo made the right choice of taking cable money to produce 13 episodes because Fox would have absolutely canceled this. They would have never aired it. They also couldn't have done a lot of stuff just in this episode that they do. They couldn't do on even 9 o'clock or 9:30 on Fox.
It was too racy for 94
Fox. That's another thing. It's a really, really mean show. Yeah. It's really mean, cynical.
But it's got a heart to it. It's got
especially
a...
Especially this episode. Is that why you chose this episode over the pilot?
I did, because people think of Duckman, they think of just a ranting, crazy duck creature. Mm-hmm. But I feel like there is a world-weary Kurt Vonnegut sense of humanity beating at the heart of the show that desperately wants things to be better for everyone. But there's a sense of, like, sometimes you just have to give up because it's too much.
Well, those are the best Duckman episodes. But other Duckman episodes are just like, no, Duckman is a heartless sociopath.
Yeah.
He would murder everyone in the world if he could have sex with this other woman.
You're like, not supposed to like... I mean, he's a fun character to watch, but he's also like, this is the bad guy. Like, yeah. He has the worst morals.
Henry has said it on numerous occasions. Like, we could laugh at this Eric Cartman, Archie Bunker-esque character, but your dad, like... found a lot of
my dad liked
value in Duckman.
Non-ironically. Well, that is, you know, if we're going to talk about our histories with Duckman and watching it ourselves, I didn't really catch on until probably when the second season started airing, or maybe in the reruns of the first season, so later in 94. Watching it every Saturday night with my dad became kind of a thing. We would watch it together, and it was just something like, me and my dad don't see eye to eye on a lot of things, but we really enjoyed the show. Like, he had kind of stopped watching The Simpsons at that point, even, I think.
Liberal.
Well, he definitely turned his back on King of the Hill after the first episode because he felt it was making fun of Republican type.
So when he watched Duckman, was he like, he'll tell us what to do?
I mean, I think he liked how debaucherous Duckman was, and he probably saw him like, that's what a guy's guy is. Maybe that's what his feelings
was. And he does fluctuate between an Archie Bunker type and someone very relatable and sad. And this episode emphasizes that real well.
Well, and Everett Peck, I found an interview, Everett Peck named this as about face as one of his all-time favorites.
It's one of the saddest episodes of such a balls out weird funny comedy I've never seen an ending this sad.
Yeah, well, I mean, so that's why it stuck in my memory.
But well, so how did you guys discover Duckman?
I want to say, so I have a weird uncle, and he was weird then too, who got me into a lot of cool stuff, like, I don't know, Mystery Science Theater and things like that, just letting me know about these things that existed that I didn't know about. And one of them was, like, he was, like, really into the idea of Duckman. And I think Space Ghost interviewed Duckman on some daytime Emmy Awards.
And the Cable Ace Awards?
Something like that. And then, like, he's like, oh, come in here. You got to see this Duckman thing. And I was like, oh, okay, cool. This was before the premiere. It was sort of like Space Ghost talking to Duckman about his new show. And I was on board from, like, the first season onwards. But, like, eventually it disappeared into, like, the depths of USA, like, post-midnight programming. And then I eventually caught up with a lot of it when Comedy Central would air at, like, at 2 a.m., a much better time zone.
With
in like
critic.
The early aughts and with the critic,
I missed most of the final season. I missed a lot of the final season. I remember getting to watch the second half of the final episode and also not knowing it's the final episode. And that's something too that I feel like can't happen to me anymore, of just realizing, unless it gets shockingly canceled ahead of time or they just decide to keep it a secret for some reason, you know when the last episode of something you like airs.
People will promote the last episode.
But
now,
it was such a
comedies.
Weird thing to be watching this Duckman and be like, wait, this is wrapping up everything. Like, is this the last episode? And then it ends on like a mean ass cliffhanger. Well, not a mean cliffhanger, but a big cliffhanger that's meant to never be resolved, honestly.
Yeah,
like,
and we can say what it is.
Yeah, it is that it reveals his wife was somehow alive this entire time, and that Cornfed knew the entire time, and then it ends on it to be continued. But they knew they weren't coming.
Yeah, Everett Peck has said, I will not tell you what happens unless Duckman comes back, and then we'll have to answer this question.
But that'll never happen. But anyway,
it never will happen, and God, I wish it would. So, to get into, I mean, we will start talking about the episode soon. This is more Duckman info, so...
I love talking about Duckman because it deserves more fans. It deserves to be seen. It's really good.
And it's all on YouTube.
It's all on YouTube.
And I want to say, these DVDs are in print, and you can have all of Duckman for less than $70. Sorry, less than $60. And I say, go for it. I mean, they're better on DVD, I think, anyways. I mean, you get the high-quality SD, adaptation.
And Everett Peck actually drew original covers for it, which is pretty cool.
It's strange. They're all on YouTube, but not all on the same channel. Because a lot of people who went to the trouble of uploading everything in, like, Duckman YouTube channel. The first season is littered with Frank Zappa music, and I wasn't really able to understand what that deal involved. Because he's credited in the end of this episode of, like, special music from Frank Zappa, and unlike Henry, I love Frank Zappa.
I mean, he was working on the show with Everett Peck until he died, I think.
He was dying. Yeah. He was dead by the time, we know from the previous Talking Simpsons.
I couldn't get my head around whether he was contributing new music or allowing access to the library. Because Frank Zappa wrote 2 million songs.
I believe it was library access. And that they were just, and they also cast a Zappa on the show.
Yeah, Dweezil Zappa.
So well, let's talk about that cast.
I want to go into the actual creators of the show first.
Okay.
The showrunners for all four four seasons are Jeff Reno and Ron Osborne. You probably haven't heard their names a lot. I mean, so they started in the early 80s just like working through the doldrums of sitcoms and stuff like Mork and Mindy. They worked on Night Court, which is an okay show. I'm
those
okay with Night Court.
Those are sitcoms I like.
I mean, Night Court is also horny just like Duckman, so I'm okay with
Night
it.
Court.
They worked on Moonlighting and their writing partners. Also and horny. Together they wrote Meet Joe Black and The Radioland Murders. So,
I love Radioland Murders. Yeah, Brian so, Ben, underrated.
These dudes wrote those movies, worked on these TV shows. I don't know what they're doing now, but they were the showrunners of Duckman. But we can talk about the cast. So number one, Jason Alexander. At the height of his Seinfeld fame, coming in and doing every episode of Duckman, just destroying his voice, no doubt, with these I mean, Duckman is never not screaming.
It's incredible. Yeah. I mean, but long soliloquies, only now that I can hear, I can see where they might have stitched that take together. But really, really long, shouty rants.
Well, when I watched an interview with him, he misremembered a couple things, but he said that when he auditioned for the role, he thought it was going to be a one-off or just a quick cartoon voice. And he says that had he known he'd be playing him for years, he would not have used the voice he used because it tears his voice apart.
And I feel like, I mean, I don't think Duckman is a, obviously, I don't think it's a bad show, but I feel like Jason Alexander is basically doing charity after the first 2 years. It's like, no one is watching Duckman. You're one of the most famous TV actors ever.
I would call George Costanza in the top three greatest television characters of all time.
When I revisit Seinfeld, it's just like, George is number one. Like, George is all I want to see. Where's George? What's he doing? Like, Jason Alexander is a treasure.
He's a meme machine for a reason.
He is the hottest, he's one of the hottest stars on TV at the time. Like, Seinfeld is starting to explode.
Yeah.
It'll be even bigger by into the third season of Duckman.
I think we're in about season five of Seinfeld. Yes. So, playing his angry sister-in-law, Bernice, is Nancy Travis. We know her from Becker, and that's about
Becker.
All I know
so
her from.
So I Married an Axe Murderer.
Okay,
me.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
The love interest.
And the amazing Tim Allen show that
she
I loved a lot.
She was the wife on the Tim Allen show.
And I mean, I don't want to slag on her. Whenever I see her in things, I'm like, she's a bad actor. But in Duckman, she's great.
She's amazing.
Like, she is great as Bernice.
I think you can give that to Nancy Travis. Got handed a lot of very bad roles in the 90s.
That too,
because women, I Married an Axe Murderer is one of her best
It is,
she
because
gets
she gets to make jokes and be like a charming person rather than just the object of affection, which is what she got cast as.
Yeah, like,
and when she aged out of that, I haven't seen her.
I mean, like any actress in Hollywood.
Well, so how many funny lines do you get when you're the doting wife of Tim Allen? And I felt like she was cast just to be like, this is supposed to be an old ass sitcom. Mm-hmm. This is supposed to feel like a 90s sitcom. So let's get another person that made people go like, oh, I remember her on a sitcom too. Mm-hmm. But but Nancy Travis she has great chemistry with Jason Alexander too. They work so well together.
I mean, I don't know if they recorded together, but it doesn't matter because you can just, you feel the anger between them, the unquenchable anger.
Yes.
So we have, we mentioned.
Is she the mom on The Oblongs too? Is that
No, that was one of the ladies from Designing Women. I forget who it was. But so there's Dweezil Zappa playing Ajax, the dullard son. You might know him as Chris from Family Guy because it's the same character.
Man, that's true.
And then we have Charles and Mambo, the conjoined twins, and they're played by Dana Hill, RIP. She played Max on Goof Troop and a lot of other roles.
Yeah.
And E.G. Daly, who played Tommy Pickles and Pee-wee's girlfriend in Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Dottie.
So, and Duckman's mother-in-law, Grandmama, only communicates in farts because she's in a coma. We'll hear her at the beginning of this episode.
No, in flashback, she's voiced by Nancy Travis, which is a thing on the show, too, that Nancy Travis voices every woman in that family. Huh. In flashback, she will voice Beatrice when they introduce a triplet.
Beverly.
Beverly, she voices her. And in the flashback where of the Funky Duckman, that she also does the voice of Grandmama.
I think that entire episode is a Bridges of Madison County parody.
Oh my God,
how he meets Beatrice.
I didn't write that down, but that's number one on the bestseller list right now.
Oh yeah, for sure. It has to be. Another just a straight up voice actor, Greg Berger, plays Cornfed, a fantastic parody of Jack Webb from Dragnet.
He's
and he
so
plays
good.
Off Duckman so great.
One of the greatest animated characters of the fucking decade.
Yeah, he's just so understated and everything.
He's so funny. Rewatching episodes, he is now my favorite character on it. And Greg Berger, I think, is most famous to people our age as he was Grimlock on Transformers. Me, Grimlock.
Really? Okay.
And he was Orson the Pig on U.S. Acres, the less funny part
of
Garfield.
Wow, he played two famous pigs.
Yeah, and that he...
I'll stand up for U.S. Acres.
I remember walking by him at a convention. He was at a table, and I was like, man, I want to say hi, but... I don't want to give him $20 for a signature. I feel like I'm going to get stuck into that.
I love Corn-Fed so much.
I give him $50 for a Corn-Fed voice.
He is the understated heart of this series.
Yeah.
And Greg Berger is still at it. If Grimlock appears in any Transformers game, he is still Grimlock.
I will be the retarded dinosaur. I can do this.
Corn-Fed is often the moral compass for Duckman when he needs one. And I think, I heard on a Simpsons commentary, Greg Berger for Sideshow Bob episodes when they're doing table reads, because Kelsey Grammer is a busy guy. He can't just show up at a table read.
There were a ton of, great guest stars and recurring ones.
Yeah.
Eddie Deason. I'm on the show.
Ben Stein, before we knew about him and
his
problems.
But an animated version of himself.
He played a character named Ben Stein.
It's insane.
Correct. And that was Duckman's neighbor, Ben Stein. People like Gilbert Gottfried.
The greatest is Tim Curry.
Yes, as King Chicken.
So the King Chicken episode, he was King Chicken, his Moriarty, Duckman's Moriarty, who was much smarter and better than Duckman, but was somehow beaten by him every time. But the best thing was that in every King Chicken episode, it was a mystery that he was pretending to be somebody in his life who would then be unmasked to be King Chicken.
Yeah.
But Tim Curry was voicing the character the entire episode. Yeah. And so if you were a super fan, you'd be like, wait, that's Tim Curry's voice.
Yeah.
It's the King Chicken episode.
I mean, he's talented, but he can only hide that British accent so much.
Tim Curry's the greatest. Yeah. I love him so much. Please never die, Tim Curry. Yeah. Only get better.
And his performance is so great. But I think it's time to talk about the episode about Face. We just want to give you some Duckman history. It's been half an hour.
Oh, sure.
Let's start off as Duckman plays Monopoly with Grandmama.
Unlucky seven, Dame Fortune, she's a cruel mistress. Let's see, this is your piece, I do believe, and you must move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 spaces, which lands you smack dab in the middle of my rainforest logging company. Which brings the grand total you now owe me to $164,552.17. What the heck? Let's round it up to an even 200. What's that you say? I couldn't pay that back if we played 100 games? Oh, my goodness, what to do? Wait a minute! A simple X on the dotted line, changing a few irrelevant clauses in your will, dealing with...
Oh, Duckman! You weren't trying to worm your way back into that will, were you?
Why, Bernice, I'm appalled.
So I wanted to include that whole clip because just to let you understand how great the Foley is on Duckman.
Yeah.
Watching it again, I'm like, every webbed footstep is captured. Yeah. Things are making a lot of noise in the background. When Duckman's in his office, you can hear cars honking and people on the street and things like that.
That's really good. You know, I didn't even notice that now until
it's
hearing
footsteps of the Simpsons.
Klasky Csupo made things a little too noisy for the Simpsons, but I feel like with the chaos of Duckman, it works really well here.
It is a loud, intense show. Yeah. So you kind of need that.
Bombastic production. And you were right to call me out on the Leisure Time Farts episode.
Oh.
That is not Grandmama's fart that I used from the pilot. The one you used originally, that's her consistent fart.
Yes, like the lower pitch, more emotional farting. Yeah.
Well, and so the opening is so Rugrats as well, or it's just really the Klasky Csupo opening of a close-up on something that will disorient you at the start, and then you're like, oh, that's what that was.
Yeah, and I want to say it's not as well animated as The Simpsons in terms of budget, but I think it takes more creative risks. Like, this episode opens on a city, but then it shows you it's actually Monopoly City, because the dice hit buildings and stuff like that. So
though it is a darker 90s Monopoly, just like
the Rainforest Logging Company.
Rainforest Logging Company. It's a gray, shitty world, and that's the world the Duckman lives in, is a sad, destroyed dystopia of basically LA. I don't think they ever really say it's LA, but it is definitely
LA. It's like writers living in LA and hating it. And you know, like I went back to the show thinking like this is going to be a little more right leaning than I remember, but it really isn't. And we learn from Charles and Mambo's contest they're entering just where Duckman stands on the corporatization of America.
You want to see our project for the corporate theme science fair? Our Master Cigarettes, Vein Burster Beer, and Splatco Handguns are sponsoring a category called Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Other things kill people, too. Hence the Titanic. 1,503 non-smoking, non-drinking, non-gunshot deaths.
I thought this kind of blood-sucking corporate greed and hypocrisy makes you boys sick.
True, but there's a cash prize.
So there you have it. And it is a bit funny. I watched this with 2017 eyes. Mm-hmm. It's just like, I kind of idealized the 90s. I realized they had problems, but I'm like, Duckman, the show, you're a little naive about how bad things are, because at this point, corporations aren't people yet.
Yeah.
They're still fallible organizations.
They aren't legally people in America. They don't own as much stuff as they do, and there's way more corporations because they haven't all merged yet.
Yeah.
But But the spirit of it is still there of just like a corporation. The schools are failing, so a corporation is paying to basically propaganda in schools.
For the children to make
things
propaganda.
Things that kill more people than alcohol, tobacco, and firearms.
Yes. Yeah.
And I had the same feeling when thinking about Duckman and like, is this the Republican show? But now I watch it and it's like, no, this is me as a teenager. It hates everything.
Yeah, yes.
Everything is lame and stupid and boring and has a flaw.
It's
and
both
is secretly
sides-y.
Shitty.
Yeah, it's both sides in that way. It's just like fuck everything.
Yeah,
it's
everything sucks.
It's just a very punk rock feeling
of
the show, too.
There was a certain moment, like, well, Ajax reminds me a lot of the Young Ones, which to me is most punk rock comedy thing I can imagine. He breaks everything just by moving around.
Yeah, just with a very deadpan expression on his face.
Yeah, I just like how incidental Bernice's violence to Duckman just is now. She's like, I'm just going to kick you in the face.
Yes.
And I think in season one, there's even an episode where I don't have the encyclopedic knowledge of Duckman I have of The Simpsons.
Same here, yeah.
But in season one, there's finally an episode where they're just like, or maybe season two, where it's like, you know what? Fuck this. We are fighting. Like, this is going to be big Duckman Bernice
That's
fight.
That's true, yeah. I mean, like...
Long before Peter hit Lois.
What they don't have on the show is Matt Groening, who did not want The Simpsons to be cartoony. Duckman kind of indulges in, like, Duckman can get smashed, he can do wild takes, he can just get injured.
Duckman walks around naked all the time, like Donald Duck's bottomlessness, and so only for jokes do they occasionally point out, like, yeah, I'm nude, but otherwise that's just Duckman. He's a cartoon character in a world full of humans, but also human-ish animal people.
Yeah, like weird dog ladies and things like that. I mean, no human in this world looks good. Even the sexy women are drawn to be like classy chupo sexy, which is not very sexy. So,
and I like the early hint at Duckman's loneliness, because he's like, even though he hates Bernice and she hates him, just the idea that he could go he'd be invited to the movies with her, he'd like perks up like, oh, I could go?
He is excited. I guess she was going to have him drive the car around because parking is bad, but her friends, who are very, very butch lesbians, show up to pick her up. They're lifting weights in the bed of the truck. I mean, it's 94. So
that was something they didn't hit on as often as I thought with Bernice, but that definitely was, Bernice is a very aggressive woman with a tight haircut who is health obsessed, and also it's more of a joke in the pilot of like her not letting Duckman eat real food, as in it's all just like wheat germ and whatever the health fads were at the time. So her exerciseiness and man hating would definitely is an easy way to do butch lesbian jokes.
I feel like that was a much more prevalent stereotype in this time. Like, if you hate men, you're obviously a lesbian, or you're a lesbian because you hate men.
Though there's only one episode where she thinks she's a lesbian, which is when...
Right.
Most women don't even get that on sitcoms.
So, quick version is, the King Chicken is undercover to try to, as a woman, to try to get Duckman to sexually harass him, which he doesn't, which everyone's shocked by. And then, meanwhile, Bernice is falling in love with this woman, and she's very troubled by that. And so when
I do remember this now,
it's revealed at the end that it's King Chicken. She's like, you mean this whole time I've been in love with this horrible monster of a man?
She's very relieved about that. So up next, I have this clip where it sort of, if you've never seen Duckman before, it really kind of underlines just how fast-paced the dialogue is between all the characters. This is
that
Bernice.
Whole thing was so fast there.
Like, yeah. I mean, these scripts must be like 60 pages long, and they squeeze in 20
whenever
minutes.
Whenever we talk about older media, I say the only difference in most modern media and older media is pacing. Like, every 10 years, the pacing gets faster, but Duckman is still faster.
It feels like it's made for our diseased millennial minds. Yes. And here is Bernice giving her babysitting demands to Duckman.
Make sure the kids eat a balanced dinner, Duckman. Don't just order them some fat, cholesterol-soaked pizza, then fall asleep on the couch watching the String Bikini Volleyball Channel, allowing the three of them to have the run of this place like some masked terrorist in a Middle Eastern city.
You worry too much, Bernice!
You can hear the lesbians lifting weights in the back of the truck.
Good Foley right there. Yeah, that was so fast. I wonder how many takes they were with all of them. Just like, no, faster,
you
faster.
You hear Nancy being out of breath.
I just love how stylized the dialogue is. Just like characters would never speak like this, but it just underlines every element of Duckman.
No human would say that.
Yeah.
No normal person would say it. And then it cuts to the exact thing she described of Ajax walking around with a mask on.
Yeah, and they're playing like quote-unquote spooky Arab music. Like,
he is watching the String Bikini Channel, which, again, that felt like a sideways knock at USA of just like, yeah, you just show bikini movies at night so sad men like Duckman can jerk off to it and fall asleep. And I got a good chuckle on second viewing, noticing that it is literally, the brand is fat and cholesterol-soaked pizza.
See, Bernice didn't know it's actually carbs that are bad for you. Yeah. She's on that 94 anti-fat and cholesterol
trans
kick.
Trans fats, Duckman.
I mean, the carbs of pizza aren't great either.
So at this point, Charles and Mambo, so they're still at home, and Charles and Mambo, the conjoined twins, are arguing with each other whether it should be the Titanic or the Lusitania, when Mambo gets the model of the ship caught in his throat in a scuffle, and Duckman has to call 911.
Ships. On your Dory lollipop minnow Poseidon. Here we are, Titanic. Can you get a hold of some ice?
Ice, got it. Now what?
Pour the ice into his throat, making sure to hit the starboard bow of the hull below the waterline.
Iceberg, dead ahead!
So the ship breaks in half in Mambo's throat and just sort of falls down into his digestive tract.
It's cute that he had to sink the Titanic in his throat. It's a cute little joke. Also impressive that they did it 3 years before Titanic craze took over America. Mm-hmm. Like, I know everybody associates the Titanic with one of the biggest films of all time and a love story and hearts going on.
Yeah.
But that wasn't what Titanic meant in 1994.
I mean, was that iceberg right ahead? Mm-hmm. Was that like a line people knew? Because Duckman says it before the movie.
I mean, it was definitely famous that an iceberg would hit it, and so
that actual like choice of expression feels like pretty prescient.
Yeah, it seems like a reference to the James Cameron movie.
And the difference is the Lusitania was sunk by Germans in World War I, May 1915, killing 1,198 civilians. It was not a warship, though the Germans saw it as a ship bringing supplies to London, their enemy.
Just had to get one negative comment in.
Was that more than the Titanic then?
No,
or less?
The Titanic had 1,575. Okay. So Mambo is correct that using the Titanic.
I see. As someone rewatching a lot of Duckman in my spare time while I play with my marijuana card.
You got to use it to buy marijuana, Chris.
I know. But they don't normally acknowledge the conjoined twin status of one another, but it is funny that one of the twins is about to die and leaving a dead...
It's like, unless you want like a dead head on that sitting next to me for the rest of my life.
I did like that, and it is... One thing that is the most dated in this episode is pulling a book off a shelf find an answer to something. Like, that would...
They would have a much better database now at 911.
Exactly. They would be able to... They would just Google what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
I'm Duckman, someone you never heard of, doing a show you've never seen on a night you're never home. Why the hell am I spending money on a commercial?
You're not paying. USA is paying.
And a fine network it is. Boneheads.
Duckman, Saturday nights at 10:30, 9:30 Central on USA.
Thank you guys so much for listening, and if you like listening to stuff, it's a good thing this episode is brought to you by Audible. And before I tell you more about it, know that you can go to audibletrial.com/lasertime and get started with a free audiobook and a free 30-day trial of all Audible is. What is Audible? They've got over 180,000 different titles to choose from, ranging from audiobooks, comedy albums, radio shows, some of my favorite old-timey radio shows, and you can listen to them all on your iPhone, Android, MP3 player, desktop, tablet, doesn't matter, wherever you can plug in headphones. Audible's got all your bestsellers, your Game of Thrones, your Harry Potters, the latest biography from whatever comedian is you like, and they have become my go-to place to get audiobooks for an incredibly low cost. So once again, that's Audible, people, and you can go to audibletrial.com/lasertime and get a free audiobook and a free 30-day trial of the service.
It's Raw, it's Duckman next on USA.
You like Laser Time shows? Then you might like Bonus Time, Laser Time's weekly bonus show exclusively on patreon.com/lasertime. Here's a taste of what you've been missing.
We did it like the day the show came out. Well, Dave didn't volunteer his time for his country.
No, no.
Brett and I went to work at the food bank with
they
Chuck.
They can their own damn vegetables. last
week we with Grim and Charlie.
Yeah,
went to a food bank and packed frozen corn into bags for 3 hours.
He did. And then they're like, who do you think all this food goes to? Of course, none I don't fucking answer because I know he's setting me up for a wrong answer. You guys should have been able to tell in this week's Laser Time. But actually, 15% of our food goes to the homeless. I'm like, what? All right, please fill us in on where it goes.
The rest goes to people who have too many homes. Not enough corn to put in all those homes.
No, it was sort of eye-opening. It goes to, because I forgot about Meals on Wheels, the kind of thing like get food to people who can't leave their homes. Then do you know anybody in the city who works, pays their rent, pays their bills, and has zero money left for food? That's also who we deliver food to, which heartened me.
Classic freeloader.
Wait, can I get
exactly,
on that?
Right?
Like,
I can but warning, I may have sneezed in your corn.
Okay. If you want one bag of frozen corn, cool.
Get bonus time, Laser Time's weekly full-length, uncensored, and ad-free Patreon-exclusive podcast, as well as weekly full-length movie commentaries, wrestling and cartoon video commentaries, physical rewards, the first season of Talking Simpson, and more at patreon.com/lasertime, starting at just $5. You'll help us live, and we'll do our best to help you never be bored again.
So Duckman falls in love with the 9/11 operator's voice. It's so angelic. And he has to tell Cornfed, his partner at the detective agency he works at, just what's happening with his love.
An angel, Cornfed. One phone call and I was swept away. She is everything I ever hoped for in a woman.
Low standards.
I'm keeping my fingers crossed. It was incredible, Corny. The way she made me feel things as I listened to her.
Excuse me, if this is gonna get sorted.
Emotions, okay? I felt emotions. The kind I never feel anymore. And it's all because of a voice. That sweet, willowy reed of a voice. I want to do things with her, Corny. Fun things, exciting things. I want to paint her living room. I want to go to the tar pits. I want to surf.
The problem, though, is Duckman can't figure out who the operator is because apparently an escaped serial killer has been following 911 operators home and killing them. So Duckman can't find out who this person was.
I love that line so much because it implies horrible, horrible things are happening in his city, but he doesn't even care.
Yeah.
And the way Cornfed reacts to like another concerned citizen stopping you from doing this, overly worried people.
The nanny state
all
again.
Part of the needless cruelty that permeates. Throughout Duckman.
Yes.
And that
just in the background, just like the background radiation is just you know, nastiness and anarchy.
Well, and Angela's voiced by Lolita Davidovich.
Mm.
And she'd later appear in an episode of Curb Your Enthusiasm, which is Jason Alexander adjacent show.
Yeah, so it's in the greater Alexanderverse.
Yes, exactly.
So two characters we didn't name are Fluffy and Uranus, who are sort of like the itchy and scratchy of Duckman, So they are like the fluffy, like super cutesy, super teddy bear-ish creations that are Duckman's receptionist. One is blue, one is pink. Mm-hmm. And the main appeal of them is they can be killed in many ways. They're kind of like immortal creatures they can just destroy.
Before Kenny, Duckman killed his receptionist every single episode.
Constantly.
Yeah, I love it. I love it so much. Oh, by the way, the line is, one more overly cautious reactionary in a position of authority. I was so happy that this was the episode because one of my favorite gags was seeing Fluffy and Uranus torn apart in different ways or murdered in different ways each episode. And this has an entire montage of it set to Love American Style and
does.
The real song.
So let's hear Duckman start his murder spree with Fluffy and Uranus. he's trying to kill them in different ways so he has a reason to call 911.
Because it would be illegal to fake a call, so he has to do horrible things to him.
As if Duckman is better than that, but let's hear him get this idea.
Well, season one, Duckman's better than
that's true.
Too bad it's against the law to make dozens of 911 calls till you find her if you're not actually reporting a real emergency.
Fluffy! Uranus!
What can we do for you, Mr. Duckman?
An impersonation.
Of what?
Drowning victims! Help! My sons fell in the pool! They're going under!
Okay, stay calm. Is there a rope you can throw them?
Do you have a cold?
No.
Forget it, they gotta learn to swim sometime.
Again, I love the heavy phone slamming down, and he's drowning them in the water cooler.
And then he just tears them apart over and over again in a great montage. And at first I wondered, like, hey, Charles Amambo should be forever thankful to Duckman for saving one of their lives. But then I can understand why they hate him again in the episode when he tries to make them choke again.
Yeah, like, so it's all part of a montage. Like The Simpsons, they use the Love American Style song, which I'm not sure if that's on the DVDs or not. They did take some of the licensed music out of
it. On the YouTube, it's the original
yeah,
song.
Yeah, it's definitely there, but he kills them with an electric fence, they're run over by a semi, they're killed with a circular saw, and then chased by hungry dogs. And as Henry said, Duckman tries to serve them a model ship, Charles and Mambo, yes, to get them to choke again.
To choke it, like it's just he like sprinkled some spaghetti on top of it, and they just the way they glared at him, he's like, I can't blame a guy for trying. Like,
so Duckman's at the end of his rope, and I love how Ajax enters this scene. He just throws a garbage can through the window, like, hi, Dad. Just with a dead look on his face. I love Ajax.
And the Duckman's ready to throw his life away by smoking again, which is a good setup. Him smoking is a payoff in this episode.
It really is,
so
yeah.
It's him giving up hope and just going like, I should smoke. And also that he says, he admits like, well, son, if I smoke, I'm both going to kill myself and I won't be politically correct anymore.
So Duckman's willing to just do this out of spite for the world. Yeah. And it's important to note that he throws the match and then it starts lighting the living room on fire around him. So as this conversation happens, we're going to hear Duckman's house just like be enveloped in flames. So this is a long clip, but I think it's worth it.
You know, a lot of people don't keep their heads in an emergency.
Oh, it was your voice. It made me feel like, well, like everything would be okay.
Well, the reason I called is I'm new here, and your son's was the first life I've ever helped save. I just wanted to follow up. I never want to forget there are real people on the other end of the phone.
Wow.
What?
Nothing. I was just glancing down at my bicep. At the risk of sounding like a pimple-faced schoolboy, I was wondering... sorry, I'm just not very good at this. I was wondering if... Well, you'd like to have dinner with me tonight.
Dinner?
You only have to buy your half. Just think of it as a way to say thanks for saving my son's life.
Well, you sound nice. Okay, I'll do it.
You will?
There's a little Japanese restaurant on 3rd Street. Do you know it?
Yeah, I think so. Just down from Vic's Flesh Button. G-string and... I'll find it. I'll find it. Shall we say, half an hour?
Half an hour it is.
She said yes! This little ducky has a date! Oh, happy day! Kaloo, Kalay! I'm going out with Angela!
I have to underline just the visual splendor of Duckman's living room slowly catching on fire. Yeah. There's one point where the couch starts burning at both ends, and before it can reach him, he stands up and starts walking some other place.
Well, I like how Ajax... Duckman doesn't notice, but Ajax definitely does notice.
But he's not concerned.
No, he's not. It's just a dead look on his face. He just will take one step away. He's like, well, just one step over so not burn. He at least has the smarts to know that he doesn't want to be on fire. But
and I think like the people writing the show are smart enough to know like this is a cartoon. We can't have this dialogue-heavy scene just go on with nothing cartoony happening.
It's just
so...
a meat cute. Yeah. Like, it's a sweet one, but they have to have this conversation, but something visually interesting
if you're juxtaposing it with The Simpsons, they wouldn't have had a dialogue sequence this long.
No,
ever.
I don't think they would.
And it's funny, like, if you watch Duckman, it is a very, also, as cartoony as it gets, it also is very grounded. Like, an entire act will just take place in the home, in their home, before moving on to act two. Like, they're not afraid to sit inside the house for an entire act with all this stuff happening inside of it.
Well, I wonder, too, if that's also a budget thing, that they're like, we can't go to too many new places.
That could be it, too.
We can't design a new place.
I've watched a lot of the show. There's not a lot of reused shit. Mm. Like, even the paintings sometimes are different in the house.
Yeah, it's true. It's, I mean, they... There's some wild... Klatsky Chupo really went out of their way to get crazy on this. Like, I think that's another sign of the removal of Matt Groening from the process. The Matt Groening is very much like, no, the house always looks like
these
this.
Pupils are too big.
Yeah.
These tears don't go that way. In this show, they're just like, forget it.
I can't prove this happens all the time, but there's an establishing shot of the house, which is like... butt up against a freeway ramp.
Yeah, it's like,
disturbing, disgusting, the lawn is dead, the sprinkler's constantly going, and like, after this, there's always construction workers working, meaning that it's a different shot every time. It doesn't look like this in other episodes.
Just like in L.A., construction never stops.
Yeah.
And as wacky as it gets, I think the layout of the Duckman house stays the same all throughout.
I think so, yeah. Well, the design of that underpass, I'm glad you brought that up, Chris, it very much is, they designed the L.A. of, like, the Rodney King trial.
Oh, for sure,
The L.A. riots. Like, Ajax smashing the window with a trash can. I feel like in the world where the L.A. riots didn't happen, that wouldn't have been the joke.
Let's do the right thing slash L.A. Jolly Roger slash recent history, I think. Yeah.
And so, it again, one of those things that feels ripped from the headlines type moment on the show.
And we should mention that Angela called Duckman back to check up on the people she saved. So she's a very nice person. So they go to Benihana's, where it's okay to laugh at old stereotypes.
I have this image on my iPad from a year ago, so I thought it was so funny.
I do.
And I was surprised. Oh, go ahead, Chris.
It's just that it's a parody of Benihana's called Benihana's, where it's okay to laugh at old stereotypes.
Yeah.
That it's acknowledging we're aware of what we're doing.
Yeah, but they actually don't do any stereotypes of, like, Asian or...
There's one in there.
I heard maybe one, like, Japanese accent.
Yeah.
That's
a bit
much. Look, it could have gotten much worse in terms of what was acceptable in 1994.
For like, holy shit, are they going to have like a samurai show up here or something?
But that's the beauty of Duckman. It both acknowledges what it's doing and then does it.
And then does it, I also did like that there was a quick joke about that Mambo is shitting out the Titanic, too. They did.
He had to pass, like, the chimney stack or whatever.
Yeah, I like that joke. But so he's going to Benihana's. I've never been to a Benihana. I have been to a Japanese steak place.
It's basically one of those things where they, like, make the onion volcano, and it's like a show and dinner at the same time.
I mean, it's cool to watch them, like, you know, just chop up steak and cook it in front of you and just be like, oh, this is nice. Yeah. I mean, it's not cheap steak, but...
It is not.
I won't eat steak unless it's been prepared by someone I'm positive caught an egg in their head.
that's important. Oh, man, you mentioned the egg-catching thing. That's always vital to the Benihana experience.
Really? There is a Benihana's relatively near in Japantown.
In Japantown.
Yeah, which...
Wow.
Very
strange. Go there.
Whenever I've gone to Japantown, I'm like, why would I go to Benihana's, this chain place, when I want
that's where
more
you take your
authentic
parents.
Yeah. Well, I guess if you're taking your parents to Japantown and they're like... they wanted something safer, they could go to Benihana and they'd all be fine.
They need a good P.F. Chang's. So Duckman meets Angela at Benihana's, but he finds out that she is monstrously ugly. And in a very smart move, they don't actually show you a lot of her face. You see a little bit of her in her compact mirror, but you really don't know what ugly Angela looks like, which is a smart move.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, the reactions are so cartoonish in this.
Yeah. Yes.
And the descriptions, too. That there is no way, especially in the design of the show, to make her look as ugly as being described to you.
That's true.
There's no way to do it. So nothing they could show you could match what your imagination has.
I was watching this with my girlfriend, and just Duckman is an ugly character, but he's also in a very ugly world. And that everybody here is so cruel and reacts so mean to his ugly girlfriend.
Yeah.
And there's nothing they could have shown you that would have merited the reaction from the entire universe to Angela.
Well, the attractive characters even have hideous faces.
Yeah,
it's true.
But you just know they're supposed to be read as attractive, usually because of their bodies are
square
also
chin.
Good looking. Either it's a dude with big muscles or a woman with giant boobs. Like, that's how you're supposed to read them as attractive.
Yeah. But,
so that's why you need the characters to tell you so much, like, no, Angela is definitely ugly, and Duckman is a very shallow guy.
He really is, but we learn in this episode that maybe he's not. Like, he has to look below the surface of the tank.
It's the least yelly Jason Alexander is as Duckman.
Yeah, I mean...
he's sweet most of the episode.
I chose this episode in part because it's, like, the full range of Alexander in this episode. He can be very sweet as Duckman, too, so
To read into, like, knowing about... just for some reason, I was watching a Seinfeld documentary recently, and, like, Jason, he didn't want to do comedy. He's an actor.
Mm.
But a really, 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 really good one.
Yeah.
Who we wouldn't have heard of, probably, because of the way he looks, if not for Seinfeld.
Yeah.
And to me, that's what Duckman really showcases. He doesn't get to play a lot of range as George Costanza, but gets a lot of range as Duckman.
He really does, yeah. George never really turns the anxiety down past, like, 11, but Duckman can occasionally. So
you're right, yeah. He is, thanks to a weird Bob Vila scene, he's able to realize, like, no, I have to give this a chance. She may be ugly, but I just have to... I got to tough it out. I can't leave her waiting. And you do feel so sad for her when she's like waiting for him there. It's a cruel thing to do to her.
Especially as an act break. Ugly!
For as many jokes as there are at Angela's expense as her ugliness, I feel like there's also a lot of compassion for her. And she knows what she looks like. And she understands her place in the world and why it's not fair. But Duckman saves the date with the Date Saver 2000, which shuts off the power in the restaurant.
All right, I'm going to do this. Look past the obvious. Have the common decency to sit down and appreciate her for who she really is.
Are you Duckman?
I'm a sucker for ambiance.
So what I love about this scene, it is... So Duckman is very much of the David Merkin style of humor, where it's like, screw the audience, let's be as edgy and cynical as possible. And the rest of the scene plays out in complete darkness. There's like 2 minutes of darkness. You can see the exit sign.
105 seconds.
105. Wow.
Is, yes, so close to 2 minutes.
I mean,
that is a real budget saver for a show on basic cable.
It really
is.
Something
they did a lot. It was just for the situation.
No, but I feel like it was just like a fuck you, you're seeing darkness. But they also keep an exit sign in the background. I think just if you're tuning into Duckman, you're like, my TV's broken. Or something. I feel like that was a necessary thing by the network. Like, you must have some animation on the screen.
I mean, it's smart, too, just to have, like, there's got to be a drawing on here.
And the writing compensates. I love that there's a clear spit take.
Yeah.
And dialogue to reflect there's been a spit take.
Drinking bleach. Oh, yeah. She's drinking bleach yes. that he had asked for.
It's actually Drano. He gets a white wine and a Drano in case the lights come back on. And the rest of the scene is played straight, and people are being mutilated in the darkness. Like, people are being chopped apart by the Benihana chefs.
Duckman and Angela are being straight, but everybody else is, like, being murdered by chefs in the back. Like, my head!
Yeah, throw it back!
Throw it back!
And I love the Duckman line. I didn't capture the clip, but he says, I always kind of take a small truth and embellish it into, a huge lie.
Yes, so. I love that. It is a very human moment of Duckman. Mm-hmm. Like, this is, you get a full range of Duckman in this episode, and it's still very funny. Like, it's not just a bunch of, like, lovey-dovey emotions or whatever.
Yeah, a bit of the true Duckman still leaks out. And so Angela and Duckman are going to go on a second date, and Duckman arrives at the detective office, but Cornfed knows something is up.
Ah!
You're dating an ugly woman, aren't you?
How'd you know?
I've fished out of that pond a few times myself. Dinners in the basement, twofers at the planetarium, weekends in the dark room developing the pictures you took in the basement and the planetarium.
I know this sounds corny, but Angela brings out the best in me. You know what I mean?
Not exactly, no.
We've been dating for 3 weeks now, and I don't belch around her. I don't scratch hard-to-reach body crevices. I don't tell incredibly tasteless jokes. Except for the ones about hermaphrodites. I love those. So, I think I'm in love.
Duckman is still Duckman. Again, if you listen to the background of that clip, you can hear the traffic outside, like the chair moving around. It's so great.
I love Cornfeds. I've fished out of that pond myself.
It's a plot device you'll literally never see again.
No, I don't think we can do this anymore. Yeah.
No, but also, even Fluffy and Uranus, who represent PC culture, like, even they can't be nice about how good she looks or how ugly she is. But
they run screaming from the room. I'm surprised they didn't, like, kill themselves, jump into a paper shredder or something.
I mean, that does show you how much the show was very anti-political correctness for its time, and that was always represented in Fluffy and Uranus, who would be murdered by him, and they would say things like, Mr. Duckman, does this in the workplace now.
It was kind of like a Marge Simpsons running around in a bit. They talk.
A little bit or like studio notes. We're acknowledging this is wrong via Fluffy and Uranus' existence.
I absolutely think a few times they probably said things a censor told them to say. And they're like, all right. But that's the show getting its way. Like, again, I am not damning this show for being mean to PC culture.
How dare you?
It was... I'll also say, in 1994, it was a lot fresher thing to make fun of than it is in fucking 2017.
It really is, yeah.
Like, that's some hack shit if you're still making fun of the PC police, man.
So Duckman's in love with Angela, but he can't really get over her looks. But Cornfed proposes an idea that will help both of them.
I love that he says that he's in love with her so much, but he's like, well, she's kind, compassionate, caring, and I can talk to her for hours. But how long can that stay at this time?
So Duckman is really just used to masturbating, I think. It's just like, what's beyond the superficial world? Yes. And that's one reason I think Duckman can't exist in the modern world. Like, if Duckman existed in a world with internet porn, he would never leave the house.
Yeah, there's so many jokes in multiple episodes of his porn collection and all the ways he goes to a strip club, or he buys more porn somewhere.
Blow dolls.
And then now it's just like, well, he'd just be like watching cam girls and then going to Pornhub and just jumping between those things and never leave his computer.
That would be a great, like, limited animation series, just Duckman in front of his computer.
That's how they could bring it back for a new season. He just never leaves it.
So Cornfed has an idea that will help Duckman through his dilemma.
You see, even they think so. The woman shatters mirrors.
But there must be more to her than her looks.
Oh, sure. She's smart, sensitive, cheerful, thought-provoking, and loaded with empathy and insight. But how long can that stay interesting?
Duckman, you obviously have strong feelings for her. You should face your fears. Take her out on a real date. Dancing, romantic music, soft lights.
How soft?
They'd be on.
Forget it.
What if I came with you? I'll rustle up a filly of my own and we'll prove to you that you don't have to be ashamed to be seen with her.
Okay, Corny. You're right. Let's do it.
So, they are going to go on a double date to Swank's, a very upscale restaurant.
Cornfed always dates the hottest girls.
Yes. Cornfed gets some tail, although later we find out he's a virgin, and Duckman like starts Duckman lasts for like 2 minutes at it, and that's a great scene in the show.
That is crazy. I forgot he's a virgin. That really doesn't work with this episode. And
no, but it, I mean, I think it makes sense by the time they get to it. It's like, no, we never actually saw Cornfed fuck.
I guess not. Yeah. But I guess he just wanted female companionship.
Totally,
but
have
the
a friend like that. To,
yeah,
and the only reason he has sex when he finally loses his virginity is because he will die if he doesn't.
That's right. Yeah, so, he's very, very Klingon like, I guess.
Yeah, it was his
Vulcan.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
Ponfar. That's it. The point where you have to have sex. But he, see, I got the skills. I got Star Trek skills.
Ponfar happens every morning.
So he has sex with Bernice. And,
that's right.
And falls
a great
in
episode.
Love with her. And the sounds of them having sex off screen. It was pretty great.
Talk about Foley.
I've said it on a bunch of Laser Time shows. The first clear reference to jerking off I heard in Duckman.
Oh yes,
when he's staying with Fluffy and Uranus, and the bed starts shaking, and they hold each other afraid.
And then he stops, and then it starts shaking again.
It is revealed he's using a Thighmaster, though, so they can get away
that's
with
true.
It. But that's actually.
But
the
nobody
same.
Was talking about that at that time.
No,
it's actually the same episode where Bernice falls in love with King Chicken as a woman.
Oh, that's why Duckman has to move out.
Yes, yeah, but the
really good show people.
But I there's some subtle acting I really like when they arrive there on their double date. That Cornfed's date Trudy and Cornfed both can't look at Angela in the face, but they're being nice about it. But they're just like turning away.
Now that you're right, it's very subtle for those characters.
Which you don't think of subtle animation when you think of Duckman, but they pulled it off there, which is crazy because they're being surrounded by Tex Avery level or Pepe Le Pew cartoon level reactions. Like, ugh.
I'm glad you said that, because I wrote down Tex Avery like a very Ray Charles-esque blind man is playing the piano, and his dog sees Angela, jumps into the piano, and pulls in the Ray Charles guy. Like, everyone is doing wild takes to Angela's appearance.
And I love them dancing in silence, too. And like, Korf is like, there's no music. Like, then we'll just dance in silence.
Yeah.
It's like, okay.
It's very cute. And, like, so I feel like they're playing up this high comp, this, like, kind of wacky comedy to make it seem less mean-spirited that they're making fun of a woman's appearance. It's like, it's kind of cartoon wacky. Like, she is outlandishly ugly in a way that cannot be depicted with drawings.
That's what made me think of Looney Tunes, because it's a perfect Chuck Jones premise.
Oh, man!
But it only becomes more real when someone just directly insults her to her face, which actually didn't happen. Everyone's being nice around her, they're not being nice in their reactions, but nobody's saying, you're ugly.
Yeah,
everybody's trying to save her feelings.
The melancholy of realizing she is noticing all of this.
Yeah,
the
I mean,
whole
you
time.
Not live with that face and not realize how the world reacts to you.
She's aware of who she is, and we hear this happen, this kind of come to a head at this restaurant.
A rose for the lovely lady?
Whoa, or maybe a cube of sugar, huh?
Nobody insults my girlfriend! Wait a minute, where are you going?
Duckman, I've had a lot of years to get used to the fact that I was born with colorful features, but you haven't. I hate to see the look on your face when you see the looks on everyone else's, and I think it's time I did something about it. If it doesn't work, you'll never have to see me again.
It's a really sweet moment right before that where Duckman can finally look her in the face and he sees her like, I just love you. I don't.
Yeah.
I just see a woman I love.
Yeah, but what every woman's had to deal with dating me.
But it's also what ruins it for it. What's hurt? It's already the new problem in their relationship. Of just like, he can look her in the face, but now he's even more invested and can't take anyone calling her ugly.
Yeah, and
even it's a cartoon world. People treat it as like, as you would in real life, if someone punched someone in a bar or at a party, you'd be like, holy shit. Like, in later Duckman episodes, that kind of violence would just be treated like,
it'd be kind of laughed off. Yeah, and there's a very like sad and cute line where everyone just flees from Angela's face, and she says, I feel like we're all alone out here, and Duckman's like, yeah, me too, because everyone is just gone.
Well, I like that she's not, well, it's a tough thing. She is changing her looks for Duckman's benefit, but it is to save their relationship, which he is invested in.
Yeah.
But I mean, you could take the stance of a woman shouldn't change her looks for a man, that she should be happy with her looks, but she is happy with her looks, but she loves Duckman.
Yeah, and if everyone is reacting to you like with Tex Avery style freakouts, you'll be like, maybe my life would be better if I fixed a few things.
It turns a really cartoonish situation very complicated.
Yeah, there's a lot to talk about, I think.
I mean, it's not nice to be mean to somebody who mm-hmm. you think looks ugly. Like, you just shouldn't do that.
Yeah, but the idea that, like, right. she's aware and she's coping with what she looks like and who she is, but,
and
like,
she
it's
lives a happy life as an
and has forever yeah. And is free to meet people, mm-hmm. but is now affecting someone she might care about.
Yeah.
And it's not for Duckman, but it's about Duckman.
It is about,
yeah,
it was
true.
Spurred on by Duckman, and it's a choice she could have made at any time because mm-hmm. they kind of walk around it like, I'm skipping ahead, but mm-hmm. she doesn't exactly get a facelift, but mm-hmm. she kind of does. But
yeah.
she still has a rockin' figure for a duck.
Yes.
That's a duck ad for.
But she has
I'm on the angel. She's my waifu now.
Yeah. So. But anyway, she gets a completely different.
I hung
place,
it on my pillow.
But that was a pretty good act break of her just leaving.
Yeah, and for as much as Duckman is like a total sleaze, like mm-hmm. Duckman is not superficial in this case. He's like, I love this woman for who she is. I don't care what she looks like, mm-hmm. and I will attack anyone who insults her. Like, it's very, very not. I mean, Duckman likes to talk big, but he's really just a sweetheart. You know,
just like all horrible. They all are sweethearts.
I mean, Duckman's an idealized scumbag, so he's written unlike real scumbags.
Yes.
This is just one episode, by the way. The rest of the time, Duckman is a total scumbag.
I mean, he does show his sweet side, and I think they want to kind of keep that part of his character and make him somewhat redeemable.
But there's another episode where the entire town gets stuck underground, and he then destroys the rest of the city while thinking he and the mute girl are the only ones left. And
that's
then
right.
The entire town comes back up like, you've destroyed the town, and they're all out to murder Duckman.
That's another good one. Maybe we'll get to it in some time. So Act 3 opens with the house being repaired, which is like a great visual gag. Like yeah. that, the living room burned down when Angela called Duckman. Act 3 begins with Bernice like wallpapering the living room, people putting in a new window. Like they're following up on that visual gag of the house burning down around Duckman. So Duckman's going to introduce Angela to the family, and she's been gone for a while.
What's the occasion for this olfactory outrage, Dad?
It so happens I have a date and she'll be here any minute.
Oh, what does she look like?
Must you be so shallow as to focus on looks? Like society's some kind of pageant and we're all judged on a meaningless detail like appearance.
Gargoyle.
Okay, she's the bell ringer at Notre Dame. I don't care. She's mine and I love her no matter what she looks like. Truth is, I don't know what she looks like. I haven't seen her in a week. I called and called until she finally admitted she was getting a complete makeover. With a little luck, she went from hideous to butt ugly.
That's the one time we see Duckman admitting to his family, like, yes, this is what you're in for. She is ugly.
You will view her as ugly is perhaps what he's saying. But
and in 1 year, Jason Alexander would be a gargoyle in Notre Dame.
That's true, yeah.
Holy shit.
He would play Hugo, I think, in Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Oh, my God. I
couldn't remember the title.
That, but I like that Charles and Mambo are... Also, they are the cruel world, too, just like, she's ugly.
That's
like,
the sad, dated aspect of the show that we're all supposed to immediately understand, like, yeah, total woof, dude, Buzz, your girlfriend.
Well, like, Duckman can't even get his sons to be on board. I mean, like, the point of the show is, like, no one respects Duckman, his sons don't respect him. Ajax is too stupid to even know what respect is.
No,
and Charles and Mambo are kind of like dual Lisa Simpsons, in a way.
Well, they're like Lisa and Bart.
Yeah.
Like, they are as smart as Lisa... But they also are just, like, as mean, nearly Bart levels of mean to their father and disrespectful. They definitely do not respect Duckman, but they're smart enough to know when to be better,
at
least. And they can admit when they're wrong.
Mm-hmm. So Angela appears, and she is gorgeous. As Chris said, he would hang it on his pillow in the pillow waifu form. And there's some great exchanges here, just like Charles and or Mambo saying, I thought you said she was ugly, Dad. He's like, anything but ugly, son. Caitlin, that's such a key word.
You said she was but ugly. Anything but ugly, son.
Yeah.
And also that they throw out one of Duckman's catchphrases. He doesn't say it. Bernice, Charles, and Mambo say it.
Hummina, hummina, hawa,
right?
And that was just, I think everyone said that, and there would be some like weird translation. It's like, that's Cherokee for your scrotum is many colored, or something like that.
Right, I forgot that.
There would be some follow-up to it. So hummina, hummina, hawa was a Duckman thing. So Ajax is immediately in love with her when Bernice is like, well, he might not embrace you immediately. He misses his mom.
It was a sweet moment of Bernice saying, like, he hasn't accepted his mom's death. And then he's being like, Mama, and jumps in her arms. Also, another running joke they do there is Duckman getting Mambo's name wrong. He calls him Merengue.
Yeah.
This is Charles and Merengue. Mambo.
That is a running joke on the show. You're right.
It was, there'll be a clip show not too long after this one that you'll see them all together, at least all the ones from the first two seasons. And so Merengue is the one in this episode, and everyone's in love with him. I also love the line,
Is it from Bernice asking her, like, what went wrong in your life?
Well, talk about that childhood incident that left you so traumatized you thought Duckman's a catch. Ha!
Yeah, like, I mean, it's a funny line, but when I see somebody with a despicable, like, man, I'm like, what happened to you that made you like this guy?
You're worth more than this. Yeah. We say that about your girlfriend all the time. No, I kid.
Charles and Mambo plant the seeds of doubt in Duckman's head, like, you're not good enough for her now. She's too beautiful for you. And Duckman immediately...
knew what they were doing. Yeah. They were doing that to be mean.
Like, I mean, Duckman is now on the road to destroy this relationship because he is too insecure to have someone as beautiful as Angela as his girlfriend. And I mean, I feel like I've felt like Duckman in relationships. I don't know if it's a self-esteem issue. Just like, I'm not good enough for this person.
It's happened to me three really weird times. I'm with someone like, you're way more... you're out of my league, and like, and it makes me uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm. No, I've had that feeling too.
It has less to do with attractiveness in a lot of places, but like class, like you're just, I don't know, because like I realize I'm attracted to more than just looks, mm-hmm. and like, look, that took me a really, really long time to realize,
as it did with Duckman.
I've been with people like, I don't know, like I don't like what you do or who you are, really. Well, and every time we go anywhere, like. Everybody flirts with you, like, oh, stop it. Like, I wouldn't date a girl like you normally. Like, I shouldn't be here. I can't stand this.
I do, that self-esteem thing of feeling like your partner is more attractive than you or you're not good enough for them. Like, that can be a real mindfuck. I could definitely identify with Duckman's feelings here, though I could also identify with him wanting to show off what an attractive girlfriend he's got.
And he brings her to the office, and he's like, look, her eyes point in the same direction, which I guess didn't happen before. And I have to say, so Duckman has some T-shirts made, and these T-shirts resulted in my most popular tweets ever of all time. So Duckman makes a shirt for Angela that says, I'm going out with him because I want to. And Duckman's head is in the center, and his shirt says, she's my girlfriend, and I'm not paying her.
So
my tweet says, gift ideas for your next anniversary. As of this recording, it has 3,000 retweets and 7,000 likes. And I will tell you, after the 500th retweet... For whatever reason, this thing was picked up by teens. Wow. So, like, modern teens were on board with this Duckman
joke.
Much
younger than Duckman.
I was getting all of these responses like, what is this from? This is so funny. I was just like, I got to teach the kids about Duckman. If I don't, no one will.
And that's what this podcast is about.
Yeah, and my girlfriend and I watched this with pointed it out. Like, they say the kind of T-shirt it is, and it's a long-forgotten...
Oh, really?
Yeah, like a 50-50 or a halfsie. It's
oh, Collie Pot and Blend. It's like... Cotton Blend, not Collie Cotton Blend.
I forget, but like she was like, no, that's a very specific kind of T-shirt that doesn't exist anymore.
It's a joke about how Duckman did not get all cotton T-shirts. Yes, he didn't go all out for the T-shirts.
But it has a name, and like she knew it immediately. Like, you've never heard of Halfy Halfy? 50, 50?
It's Collie Cotton, as I said.
But it's a great joke. He's like, oh, and I went all out. I got a not all polyester T-shirt.
Yeah.
But also the idea of making a T-shirt at the mall that they wear as a couple. Like, that's cute.
And it's also very nice. 1994. So,
2017 in Tallahassee, Florida.
Oh, that's
where I was at this year.
Which is still 94 in some
ways. One of the only things open there.
And Angela might be the prettiest designed woman in the series.
They worked really hard to make her appealing to the human viewer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you know,
I think so.
Like, she's a very, I don't know, I don't want to say she's hot because that's weird, but it's a very attractive Duckman character.
They scaled them back to be like not ridiculously stupidly hot to where like the triangle tits are about to poke your eyes out, which is usually what the characters
well, those are the
hot,
hot
girls look like.
Girls in the Duckman universe. But
her hair color is a real hair color, which Cornsfed girlfriend was like light blue.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's an interesting too that they made Angela a duck person instead of a human. And I think it allowed an abstraction on ugliness too, that you're like, well, what is an ugly duck person as compared to a regular duck person.
We just saw her like the acne covered beak for the most part. That's
exactly
all we saw.
And her horrible hair.
Yeah.
It's like
Duckman starts dating Angela and they go out and she's getting all the attention. A construction workers cat call her, monks cat call her.
It's a reverse Pepe Le Pew cartoon now.
And she falls over for some reason, I forget why, and someone takes a picture of that, and that's now her escalation to fame as a supermodel.
To Billboard, just because we wanted to see her.
Yes, and that's actually an Evangeline reference to the famous billboard of Evangeline.
That she just pays for to have up in LA. Evangeline is... or was, I think she still exists, in the 90s, she was just an attractive model who drove around L.A. in a pink Cadillac and had photographs of her on billboards. And there were always these people thinking, like, there must be some rich actor or Hollywood executive sugar daddy who's paying for all these things, all these ads for her around town.
I don't know her full story, but it seems pretty interesting. But
I also love the joke that they're in the park and that all the animals love her, like, Snow White
like
style.
Like, very Disney-esque.
And when he tries to be nice to that deer, it mauls him immediately.
He's mauled by a doe, which is something I've never seen in any other cartoon.
Just turns
ever.
Vicious and grows all these teeth. So it shows how fast this show moves, and the Act 3 starts with Angela's makeover, and within 2 minutes, she's the most famous supermodel ever, like outshadowing Duckman in every way, making his insecurities even larger.
He's being shoved to the background of every photograph. It's impossible for them to live a normal life now, and he's feeling bad. You couldn't have a better way of showing him, the world telling him you're not good enough for her.
Yeah, and like, so we have these spinning magazine cover kind of thing happening. And every time it happens, Duckman is more in the background. And I think the last one's like, dump the duck, Angela.
Who is
you
this?
Know, yeah, like, so they decide to have one last meeting at Swank's, one last date at Swank's, sort of talk things over.
But not for her. She doesn't want one last meeting.
Well, no, it's not a last.
No,
but they just want to go on another date.
Yeah,
I
think
where they met or where they had their big date before she
Angela is still Angela. Duckman is the one who's altered by this.
I mean, I think Duckman, in terms of being, like, I think Duckman thinks this is the last time I'll see her, so I want to let her down easy. So for him, it is. And so their date is interrupted rudely in a way that Duckman probably isn't expecting.
Let's sit at the same table. I want tonight to feel just like our first night here did. We'll dance and we'll feel alone again. Just you and me.
It's Angela, our woman of the hour. Night, Angela, where hundreds of people you've never met and couldn't care less about have gathered to tell you they love you. So, let's sit you down and let the fawning begin.
So,
I really like that voice actor. He appears a lot in Duckman in between bits.
He really is. I think he even appears in live action at some points. Like, when King Chicken does his 9 millionth explanation of why he's after Duckman, I think he appears as like a newscaster telling his, like, we're going to say this, but I'll just wrap it up for you.
That's
really
right.
Briefly.
Buck, buck, buck. Yeah. And then they cut back into him. God. We got to do a King Chicken episode at least.
I really think so. Tell us if you want us to do more or if you're really angry about this.
If you've stopped listening at this point, I guess you can't tell us.
Yes.
But, so all
the comments seem lead me to believe no one will stop listening.
No one will stop. We're that addicted.
But I like the very obvious statement of all these people you don't care about and they just love you because they saw you in a picture, so they're nobody to you, but they're all going to surround you and fawn over you.
It's really underlining how empty fame is in this context, just like, especially fame based on beauty alone.
And this is your belief why this is LA.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, I also, in my research before this episode, ever Peck in an interview pretty much said is LA.
I think it could have been debatable, but this is very LA.
It's definitely LA.
It's quite LA, yeah.
With the Angela billboard, I think really just seals the deal for this being LA.
And then they cut to Duckman. Duckman just gets like literally kicked in the face out of his chair, and he's outside and he is smoking, because that shows you, it's a great visual tell of how much he's given up or his mental state.
Duckman is back on his bullshit, as they say.
I came out here to think about things, you and me, and I'm thinking maybe tonight was our last dance.
What?
You've got plenty of people who can give you more than I can now. The simple truth is, I'm not good enough for you anymore. I can't compete with the whole rest of the world. It's only a matter of time before you find something better and leave me, so why don't we save us both the wait and just say goodbye now?
Duckman, you're wrong. None of these other people mean a thing to me. I did what I did because of you, because I was falling in love with you. I'm not gonna leave you. Maybe this isn't the time. Can we meet tomorrow night? You'll feel better then. Maybe at the Japanese restaurant where we first saw each other? I'll be there at 8.
A very sad reprisal of the Duckman theme, too.
Oh, yeah. I miss that. Now I have goosebumps listening to that.
Yeah.
I would love to compare this to that first episode of The Critic. In the first episode of The Critic, it's also the main character meeting a new girlfriend.
Who is too good for him in some ways.
Who is too good for him, and everyone's telling him that. That ends with absolutely no explanation of why she left him from her. So all you have to go on is that, oh, everyone was right. She was just using him for a good review.
Yes.
She's a bad person and is fulfilling all these stereotypes of a bad woman.
Yeah.
Now, oppositely, Angela here gets like, so many other shows at this time would have never given lines like that to Angela for her to explain, I did this because I'm in love with you. I care about you, and I don't give a shit why you, if you think you're not good enough for me, I love you.
And your bullshit insecurity and fucking narcissism, superficiality, is going to destroy this relationship for both of us.
Yeah, I mean, Duckman sabotages the relationship.
He does.
She's upset by that, but they could have so easily, somebody else could have written an episode where she's like, I'm famous now, I don't need you anymore.
Yeah. That's how it would have ended on The Simpsons.
I feel like that's why this stands out for me. Angela does not sell out. She still loves Duckman, but Duckman can't deal with having someone he perceives as better than him as his partner.
And that's insane.
Yeah.
That's an insanely complicated thing for a
cartoon about a duck.
What's supposed to be a gross cartoon about a duck.
Yeah, about a horny duck.
Well, and it is self-sabotage. Mm-hmm. Like, he feels so worthless, he can't let the thing go on, this happy, fulfilling relationship for them.
Yeah,
it's
sad. Duckman, I think, in a way, wants to be miserable. He punches himself for the death of his wife. He feels like he's a piece of shit, and he can't be happy. And that's part of the theme of the show. Like, Duckman will not let himself be happy.
Well, when he goes inside his own head, he literally, like, he sees the guilt that is all-encompassing in his brain. It's out of destroy him, while his self-esteem
is
a little wimp in a cage. Like, so that is the shit that's going on in Duckman. Yeah.
I'm just so shocked that this, I don't know, I didn't expect, I've watched this episode like 3 times recently, but that it's dealing with, I don't know, perverse subject matter that no shows ever touch. That
perverse in which way?
Just in the, like, psychological imbalance, or like ways that you can keep yourself unhappy forever by adhering to, I don't know what Duckman's hang up is, because it's hard to separate the caricature from the character that he becomes in this episode.
Yeah.
But he's self-defeating his own relationship by bullshit hang-ups. Like, dude, you won.
Yeah, yeah.
You won. Like, what's your fucking problem?
He can't let himself be happy, and that's really the problem here.
It's not letting himself be happy, but hanging on to it. Like, and I have that shit, too. Like, the idea that, like, it still bothers me sometimes my girl makes more money than I do.
Hmm.
It's just not something I expected to deal with. And every once in a while, I'm like, oh, I got a raise. And like, meh, I'm going to work on Patreon forever and never get a raise.
I got to do more Noid research.
But I mean, that's how society. That's also society making you feel.
Yeah, you're the man. You should be in charge of making money.
I meet expectation Chris and current Chris together, and like, shut the fuck up. That's dumb. Like, her success has nothing to do with your success. Whereas Duckman doesn't have that. Not to spoil the episode, but it doesn't have that realization. He literally doesn't do anything.
No. Yeah, Duckman is not self-aware in the way he needs to be.
He just gives up. It's a very.
Astonishing.
Yeah, we'll play the last scene. So Duckman just leaves Angela hanging, and this is the last scene of the episode
It's a great bookend that she asks to meet him at Benihana's again, and that this time he stands her up, unlike their first meeting.
That's true, yeah. So this is the last scene in About Face.
Duckman, it's 10 o'clock. Weren't you going to meet Angela at 8?
I changed my mind. I'm not going.
What did you do to her?
Nothing. I did something for her. She's got a chance at a new life. She shouldn't settle for me. I wouldn't let her live. I'd spend the rest of our lives holding her back because I was afraid of losing her.
I'm sorry, Duckman.
Let it ring.
What a ballsy ending.
To credits with the phone ringing.
Immediately to credits at the last thing. And like,
the phone was their connection too, and he's turning his back on it.
Yeah.
Which it's all these great,
I never thought of that. That's
things.
A great visual, embellishment of the theme.
This is a weird independent movie inserted into a gross fart cartoon.
Well, and that Bernice tries to make a joke. He's like, no, we're not joking.
We're not joking. No.
Like, she's like, oh, what did you do to hurt? Nothing.
Even Bernice at this point feels compassion for Duckman.
This feels like the first time she's ever been nice to him, even a little bit. Like,
I honestly don't know if this is an abrupt ending, like, let's just end the show here, or if this was well thought out, because to me, it just surrounds me with a ton of thoughts. That's why I keep talking in the way.
I think they were going for this bittersweet ending. Like, we want to defy conventions. Mm-hmm. We don't want her to run off and just be some Hollywood floozy or whatever. We want this realistic ending about in this duck cartoon, like this realistic relationship.
And I'm real hard on myself, professionally and personally, but this is like, this is the danger of hating yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't see that a lot in other shows. Like,
I mean, you would not. I mean, The Simpsons is great, but you would not see relationships explored in this much depth on The Simpsons.
You wouldn't end an episode with, say, Skinner having so much self hate that he would destroy the first relationship.
She's better off without me.
Yeah,
it wouldn't do that. So,
but yeah, I mean, I think this is kind of like the heights of Duckman's emotionality in terms of the series. But I feel like they would dip into this pool semi often, and they would make the character more than just this like profane idiot. Who is a dangerous duck being, you know?
Yeah, and if you see his debauchery and rudeness and disgustingness as fueled by self-hate, he's like, oh, I hate myself, so I'm going to be disgusted. Like,
it really helps explain who he is and why he acts the way he does.
And that he's ultimately, in almost all the outcome of every episode, harmless because he's a coward.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
And maybe there's something to learn from that, and you should watch the show again.
Yes, please watch more Duckman. So I guess
I'd be up for more of these. I think so.
Yeah, I mean, it was really fun revisiting this. I hadn't watched Duckman in like 8 years. I think it holds up really well, and I feel like I have more fondness for it now even than I did as a kid, because I'm an adult now. I've had relationships. I've had adult-style Duckman problems. So I can be like, wow, this show really is much deeper than it ever needed to be. All it needed to be was a crude cartoon with swearing and like masturbation jokes.
Has that too.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that it's there too. It's even in this episode.
We're in our mid-30s, which I would peg Duckman's age as well. Mm-hmm. Like, we have reached that age of Duckman now, you know? And I guess now maybe, you know, it is so 90s, it very much dates it in that way.
But
I kind of like that it crystallizes a real zeitgeist of the early 90s of just like, let's be gross because the world is seemingly trying to be nicer, and let's point out these things that we see as problems in society right now. It's very much about the society of the 90s then.
There's a bit of that, but it's like, whenever I watch it, like, there was nothing else on the air like this at the time.
Not really. No.
There's nothing ever since then. And this can't exist now.
No, it really can't.
It can't exist now. So it crystallizes it as this weird fucking miracle. Like, a miracle, I don't want to say it's the greatest show ever, but like, it's a miracle that this little show exists. And there's 70 episodes for you to enjoy.
It's an amazing time capsule. They bring back everything now, but I don't think this will ever be brought back.
Like, I don't know how they
could get Jason Alexander to be like, please, Jason Alexander, just 2 hours of your time, record new stuff. Like,
they do that kind of stuff, like, how could this character survive in this reality? But there's not enough fans of the show.
No, yeah, like, I mean, if you look at the YouTube hits on the episodes, you'll see.
It's depressing!
Yeah, but I mean, everyone...
All you have to do is Google Duckman. Can you imagine a Google search? Whatever happened to the show? It's all here free. Don't care.
And I wish there was a Duckman doll I could own. I wish there was more a Duckman t-shirt I could have. But like, Duckman USA could have done much more work in making this a more of a hit, I think. But
yeah, but they didn't want it to be. Weird show with a limited... It would never be... What we love about Duckman is also why it would never be as big as The Simpsons.
Yeah.
Because it's too weird and ugly and purposefully mean and cynical and all these. It's not wrapped up in a happy family. It's wrapped up in a screaming crazy person.
It's deliciously weird. And I can't think of anything else even comparable to Duckman. And you all owe it to yourselves as animation fans and comedy fans to check it out.
Yeah, please revisit Duckman.
Money off that recommendation, you know.
Yes.
I hope you at least
90 minutes.
I hope you at least revisited About Face for this episode. And I encourage you to watch more. Maybe we'll revisit Duckman again. I just want to do this because Duckman premiered in that 3-week span of time where there were no Simpsons episodes between Deep Space Homer and Homer Loves Flanders.
Where was the Capital Critters episode, Bob?
That was canceled like 2 years prior, and that show.
Well, that is also why I wanted to do this one. I was into doing a Duckman one and a Critic one as well, because these were the first true Simpsons. Like, other animated shows got greenlit because of The Simpsons existed, but this was the Simpsons people making new shows.
Yeah, and it lasted for more than a season.
There are 4 shows The Simpsons spawned that I think have any worthy legacy in anything. And that's The Critic, but it's very much like The Simpsons.
It is.
King of the Hill, which is, let's not get into it now, but is a different thing. But it wouldn't have happened without The Simpsons. And Family Guy, which owes The Simpsons a lot. And Duckman, which is just insane. Mm-hmm. Like, it doesn't, there's nothing else I can compare
I'd
it to.
I'd also add Futurama to that list.
No,
that's you, yeah.
I would too. It's just Futurama, it's a sillier Simpsons.
Yeah, Futurama is so much just a sequel to The Simpsons. It's hard to even say inspired by. It's just, it's much. The
and
season
I love,
8 staff I'm, pretty much just walked over to the Futurama.
I'm pointing at my vendor robot that I bought when I was a fucking poor asshole and I spent $100 on a metal.
It was worth it.
Working in a Chinese restaurant delivering food. I love Futurama, goddammit. Don't ever let me. I did not mean to sound like I was slagging on Futurama.
We may might talk about that, too, at some point.
Someday we might do it. We've got lots of plans for things.
We have lots of plans. I'm rubbing my hands together.
Exactly.
So, yeah, that was our one-off Talking Duckman. Let me know if you like Talking Duckman or like Duckman in general. I want to know what you think about this little special.
Let's talk about more cartoons, man.
It's a minor speed bump in the roadway of Talking Simpsons, but I think it's one we need to acknowledge because Duckman was a great show that was overlooked because of its spot in the cable universe,
cable landscape.
Yeah.
Like, it predates the respectability of The Sopranos by, like, just a fucking year to the end of the episode.
Yeah,
the final season.
It was poor timing. I mean, USA would never. This show isn't what you. Well, the show actually has a bit in common with Raw. It's not shocking that Raw advertised, but all the rest of. Like, USA hates it has wrestling, but it's the highest rated thing on its channel. So
they'd love to cancel it.
They always have to have wrestling, but Duckman is of the same lowbrow cloth as that. The rest of their shows. At least want to pretend to have higher profile.
I'm more like Duckman than I am almost any other anime character.
I have dark moments where I think that too, Chris, so don't worry.
I'm more Milhouse, honestly.
So this has been Talking Duckman.
Mr. Burns to break your arms.
This has been Talking Duckman. I've been your host, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. My other podcast is Retronauts. Every Monday, a new classic gaming topic. Just go to Retronauts.com or search for Retronauts in your podcast device or machine. You will find at least one topic you'll get on board with. All of us in this room have recorded plenty of Retronauts episodes, including one about Bart versus the Space Mutants, one about Bart's Nightmare. Any bad Simpsons game, we're going to take on by our full force, I think.
So I've seen every episode of Duckman.
Yes.
There is a PC game.
I played it.
Really?
And finished it.
They got everybody but Jason Alexander.
And the guy who does it does a great job, but he's also no Jason Alexander.
But it was also never released in America.
It's true.
It's crazy.
And that's the last thing I have left to experience a Duckman. I would guess forever.
Yeah, that is the final Duckman product.
I wish they would do a Kickstarter on that. Like, just because I want to, like, who are you people who like the show that I like?
I think it's on Abandonware websites, Chris. You can find it. But yeah, Retronauts.com every Monday. Look up our Simpsons episodes. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure you'll find something you'll want to listen to if you just go to our directory. So thank you.
H-E-N-E-R-E-Y-G. That's my Twitter handle. You
got
can find
it wrong
me there.
After all this time.
And you can find out when new episodes of this podcast go live, as well as other big announcements I may or may not be involved in. Mm-hmm. But until then, you should support us through patreon.com/lasertime, babies.
Yeah, I've talked about Duckman a great deal on Lasertime. I don't care if you like it. I just like the idea that, like, I found this little thing that was very important to me, and it holds up very well, and I like revisiting it. I don't care what you think of this. I don't need
you to see
it.
We will make you like Duckman.
I hope people aren't sad we didn't have Homer loves Flanders this week, but I think this is
What an accelerated course we're on, that we'll be going to the fifth season by the end of the summer.
If you're unhappy with us doing other shows, I'm just trying to point it out that we're kind of delaying our end of the really good episodes. So more of stuff like this will mean there are more good episodes of Talking Simpsons for you to listen to.
Yeah, some of you would argue we're halfway done with the good episodes.
I'd
be one of them. But I want to do it until I die. So
there's some really good 11, 12 episodes.
We shall see when that time comes.
But lasertimepodcast.com is how this whole dumb shit got started. And for the time being, that's where you can find Talking Simpsons and Laser Time, which I've mentioned constantly. I was working on the DuckTales game. I'm a big fan of animated ducks in, like, I'm not crazy. They stand the test of time. Animated ducks are charming to everyone, and I don't know why.
They're just fun to watch, Chris. I love Duckman's beak flapping.
I gotta have a smarter person explain to me how an anthropomorphic duck is fucking this exceptional.
Daffy was always my favorite Looney
Tunes. Daffy, DuckTales, Donald, Howard the Duck. it, like Plucky Duck, it, like every single one of them, like Plucky Duck is, that's the Tiny Toons highlight.
Yeah.
How the fuck are ducks so popular? People try it all the time to make new ducks, and they usually succeed.
Yeah.
How does it happen?
So there's an episode of Laser Time from way back, it might not be on iTunes, called Many Ducks Were Given, that I put up in honor of DuckTales that I made of, like,
animals. There's a bit of Duckman in the episode, if I recall.
There is, absolutely. Yeah. It's one of the only panoramas he appears in for Laser Time. But I mention him a lot, because I really do like the show. And again, it's on YouTube, and we have stuff running on Laser Time TV, which I don't really care about. But Patreon.com/LaserTime. 30/2010, a great show if you care about what happened in the world 30 and 20 and 10 years ago. We'll probably talk about the Duckman finale, sadly.
Oh, it's coming up soon.
Yeah, it's coming up very soon.
97.
We're in 1987, 97, and 07 right now. Hmm. And I've had too many beers. Somebody take the plugs away from me.
Thank you so much for listening. We'll be back next week when Homer loves Flanders. Thanks for listening to Talking Duckman.
You let your down, and thrust your pelvis, whore, 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 and thrust your pelvis, whore.